gorgeous.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome once again back to episode 5 of season 5. Look at that, 5 for 5. Ladies and gentlemen, I am yours truly, Ferris Kennedy, and in the booth to the left of me, I have a man that was rumored to be romantically involved with Stevie Nicks, which therefore in 1977 caused the album Rumours because of his relationship with Stevie Nicks. None other than...
Dr. Ian Clark. You know, that rumor is true. If you look at our website, you will see a picture of myself.
At theferriswheelrockshow.com. And then to the right of me, a man that thought it was funny to give anal beads at retirement homes as gifts. None other than...
Stephen Wheeler.
You have one sick individual.
You were useful.
So, normally as we like to start off, Dr. Clark, you got some current events?
You know, this is kind of an interesting take on classic rock, but I got this list, came across the desk here at the office. A collection of people in 2020 in the classic rock genre who croaked. And the whole point is that, you know... When you look at classic rock, we're so used to them in the 27 Club and Hendrix and these guys passing, you know, Kurt Cobain. You don't expect people to start dying of old age. This is something that jazz musicians would do. You know, they'd pass away, you know, Miles Davis or, you know, so on. They get older and that's it. But rock and roll has been around for so long that it, you know, and they haven't taken care of themselves for the most part, that they're just starting to fall off the twig. So, here's the partial list. Marty Grubb from the Buckinghams. Buckinghams were a good 60s band. Neil Peart from Rush. Steve Martin Carroll from The Left Bank. Chris Darrow from Nitty Gritty Dirt Band. Andy Gill, Gang of Four. Gang of Four, wow. That's like an 80s band. Ivan Kral from the Patti Smith Group. Like, this could, you know, Dave Roebuck from Maisie Star, another... This is a current band.
He's really young.
Yeah. He's really young. Interesting. Barbara Martin, one of the original Supremes. How's this for trivia? They're in classic rock land. She passed away. She was with the other three Supremes. But I think she got pregnant or something. One of those stories. And one of the Jerry Slick. Bit of background about that. Jerry Slick was Grace Slick's husband. And he's the guy that wrote their biggest hit. You'll see the name Slick on the writing credits. Everybody assumed it was Grace. It's Jerry Slick. He just passed away. I think he was 80. Bill Rieflin used to play with King Crimson. Did some work with REM. So this is John Prine. Everybody knows that. Bobby Lewis, 95 years old, had a big hit in the 60s with Tossing and Turning All Night, which is on the Animal House soundtrack. Who else? Little Richard. Well, 87. One of the gods of rock and roll. Is an interesting one. A guy named Al Rex from Bill Haley and the Comets. Bill Haley and the Comets were pre-Elvis, Charlie Daniels. And finally, Peter Green just died. Peter Green, one of the founding members of Fleetwood Mac, and the guy who wrote Black Magic Woman.
He's the one that introduced you to Stevie Nicks in your dating years.
It's true. He had a lot of trouble, but he had no trouble matchmaking.
Wheeler, you got something interesting of someone that had a birthday recently and he's taking, what you say, Ian? Handsome courses? Or?
Yeah, I heard he's taking some handsome lessons. And from what I can tell, he looks like Paul Newman now, so it'll all pay off.
Go ahead, Wheels.
So instead of going through the usual news, I decided to help you guys that are having trivia nights.
Yeah.
Wait a few trivia points for Rush.
Okay.
Because that usually means you're the one who's going to get the points.
Oh, okay.
So the first one is, if you've ever wondered what are those really bizarre references are in some of their songs, it's usually that Rush made songs up while they were doing their sound check. So basically they met a crew member, and instead of just pulling his leg, they just made a song about him on the spot. And so that helped them warm up and at the same time helped their creativity.
Oh, man.
The other one that's really interesting is that Neil Peart would struggle to play older Rush songs during tours in his later years, but not for the reasons most people think. It's not because he was getting arthritis or anything.
Right.
It's because he was a much better drummer and those legs were actually... too basic for him at that point. So that's rather interesting.
That's a great bit of trivia.
Pert actually wanted to turn the 2012 album of the group, Clockwork Angels, into a movie. Never happened.
Interesting.
Might have been a really interesting movie. Geddy Lee originally wanted to be a guitarist, but a basement band he was part of back in the day told him that he had to replace the band's bassist. So basically, he stuck with it because nobody else wanted to be a bass player. And
yeah,
he's known as one of the best bass players.
Yeah, I know. I think that McCartney had that thing too. Nobody wants to play bass when you're young. It's not cool.
And especially McCartney had to play it backwards because he's a lefty.
Yeah, he had to flip it over, and it just was painful.
Moving Pictures was released 4 days late, partly due to an issue with the new technology Rush was using to record it.
I heard about this story, yeah.
That's one of their best albums.
It goes to show. Sometimes accidents are a really
That's their
good
best
thing.
Album. I don't like the...
And they've never had that problem since because they reverted to the old technology for everyone that there are the records. Go ahead.
Interesting trivia. I knew that story, though. It was the They do some retro stuff with the technology.
And the last little bit, for those of you who love these kinds of lists, Moving Pictures is one of two Rush albums that are in the list of 1001 albums to hear before you die. Can you guys guess the other one?
Aqualung.
Snot running down his nose.
So 2112.
Yeah, I was going to say 2112. I have that collection, by the way.
Really?
I have. Yeah, it's on like 40 CDs.
Moving Pictures, I have. I bought that for $8 at Walmart. And I just do want to say, is he considered one of the top best bassists in the world? Is that what you're saying?
He's one of the best bassists, but it's more Perth, known as one of the world's greatest drummers.
Okay, great, because if there's going to be bassists, I'm going to have to put Steve Harris from Iron Maiden on top, Duff McKagan from Guns N' Roses, and, I don't know, Michael Balzeri, who goes by Flea, is pretty damn good, and I think they could out-bass Geddy Lee. There you go.
Wow.
You don't think
you can write? Yeah, you can write this fellow at our email address, which you can find on our website.
Come on, it's been known, and you guys know that when we did the bass show, that Steve Harris from Iron Maiden is considered one of the top bassists in the world.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
So, I think Rush, give or take, is a little bit full of themselves with their instrumental prowess. After a while, I got a little weary of hearing everyone so good. Everyone's so good. Yeah, well, the Beatles, for instance, weren't great musicians in a way. Not great music, outstanding virtue. They weren't exactly Jeff Beck or these type of level, but they were great composers. So who would you rather have? You know, I'd rather have some great songs. For me, that's just my taste. Great songs, and I'll give up the virtuosity.
Yeah.
So that's where I stand. What are we talking about today?
Well, today we're talking about one of my top favorite bands.
Who would that be?
Oh, the boys from Beantown.
Oh, yes.
Aerosmith.
Dude looks like a lady for
That's
sure.
That's right. One of the first concerts.
More every year.
One of my first concerts I ever saw was actually 1994, and I was fortunate enough to see the Eat the Rich tour. It opened up with a big loud belch, which influenced me to continue belching. So
that was pretty classy.
So what are we going to talk about today? None other than Aerosmith. And obviously, as you know, in 2020, they celebrated 50 years of being a band. And their big celebration tour is going to kick off in 2021 due to COVID. They're going to kick it off in Boston. So it's going to be fantastic. So where do we go? Well, Aerosmith, they were one of the most popular hard rock bands of the 70s, set in the style and sound of hard rock and heavy metal for the next two decades with their raunchy, bluesy swagger. That's right, the Boston-based quintet found the middle ground between the menace of the Rolling Stones and the campy, sleazy flamboyance of the New York Dolls. Wow. Buster Poindexter. Go figure
Buster
that one out.
Yeah. Johnny Thunder.
That's right. So they ended up developing a lean, dirty riff-oriented boogie that was loose and swinging and as hard as a diamond. Not Neil, but just a regular diamond.
Yeah, really? Okay.
Yeah. they developed a prototype for power ballads with Dream On, which for years I thought was Joe Perry that sang it, but it was
For years I thought it was Led Zeppelin song.
And it's basically a piano ballad, which was orchestrated with strings and distorted guitars. Aerosmith's ability to pull off both ballads and rock and roll made them extremely popular during the mid-70s when they had a string of gold and platinum albums. By the early 80s, the group's audience had declined, and as the band fell prey to drug and alcohol abuse. Well, no shit, really. Okay.
Well, they call them the toxic.
They must, yeah, they must know the Chili Peppers for odd reasons. If you guys, really. So obviously, in the late 80s, they pulled off one of the most remarkable comebacks in rock history, returning to the top of the charts with a group of albums that equaled, if not surpassed, the popularities of their 70s albums, which I actually could agree to that. Yeah.
Really? Okay.
So in 1970, the first incarnation of Aerosmith formed when vocalist Steve Tyler, which is better known as Steven Victor Tallarico, a good Italian boy, met guitarist Joe Perry, which is basically Adam Joseph Pereira, a good Portuguese boy, who's also half Italian. Just, I don't know.
A lot of issues here.
Yeah. While working at Sunapee, New Hampshire Ice Cream Parlor. So these guys basically were doing ice cream, you know? Like they say in French, il faisait des gâteaux, you know? They're making cakes and ice cream. But anyways, Tyler, who was originally a drummer, and Perry decided to form a power trio with the bassist Tom Hamilton. The group soon expanded to a quartet, adding a second guitarist called Ray Tabano. He was quickly replaced by Brad Whitford, a former member of Earth, Inc. With the addition of the drummer Joey Kramer, who they kicked out, then brought back, Tyler became the full-time lead singer by the end of the year. Now, they kicked him out in 2019 for like a month or two.
Yeah, they probably deserved it.
So anyways, Aerosmith relocated to Boston at the end of 1970. After playing clubs in Massachusetts and New York areas for 2 years, the group landed a record contract with Columbia Records in 1972. Self-titled debut album was released in the fall of 73. Their third record, which was released in 75, which was called Toys in the Attic, and as they say in French, Les Jouets dans le Grenier, was their breakthrough album through both commercially and artistically. I like to beg to differ, but whatever. By the time it was recorded, the band's sound had developed into a sleek, hard-driving, hard rock powered by simple, almost brutal blues-based riffs. So you got to realize Joe Perry was influenced a lot by the Rolling Stones.
Oh, huge.
And you could tell in his guitar licks, okay? Many critics at the time labeled the group as punk rockers. Aerosmith stripped heavy metal to its basic core, spitting out spare riffs that not only rocked but rolled. Toys in the Attic captured the essence of newly invigorated Aerosmith. Sweet Emotion, their first single from Toys in the Attic, broke into the top 40 in the summer of 1975, with the album reaching number 11 shortly after. Its success prompted the re-release of the power ballad Dream On, which shot into the top 10 in 1976. Walk This Way, that was the final single from Toys in the Attic, was released around the same time as the group's new album in 1976, Rocks. Although it didn't feature a top 10 hit like Walk This Way, Rocks went platinum quickly, peaking at number 3. To get to Walk This Way, I actually prefer the remake Run DMC.
I completely agree.
I do. In early 77, Aerosmith took a break and prepared material for their fifth album, which was released in late 77, Draw the Line. Climbing to number 11 on the US charts, but it showed signs of exhaustion. In 1978, the band appeared in the movie Sgt. Pepper Lonely Hearts Club Band performing Come Together, which eventually became a number 23 hit. Live Bootleg appeared in 1978 and became another success, reaching number 13. Now, there's a little bit of story with the Sgt. Pepper soundtrack. It actually ruined Peter Frampton's career.
It ruined his career.
And the only thing that really came out from this soundtrack was actually the Come Together remake, which turned out to be good.
Yeah.
The rest of it, unfortunately, is not.
Can you believe it? Talk about disaster. You got these great groups like the Bee Gees, all these guys, and it's just the worst thing they've ever done. Frampton had a bad album after Comes Alive. I remember Rocky's Heart House or whatever. Anyway, and then he did this dopey movie, and they tanked. You're right. That's a really good point. The best thing to come out of that movie was Come Together.
That's it. Then later on, in 1979, Aerosmith recorded Night in the Ruts, releasing the record at the end of the year. By the time of its release, Joe Perry had left the band to form the Joe Perry Project.
Yeah.
Night and the Runts performed respectfully, climbing to number 14 and going gold. Yet, it was the least successful Aerosmith record to date. Brad Whitford left the group in early 1980, forming the Whitford St. Holmes Band with former Ted Nugent guitarist Derek St. Holmes. As Aerosmith regrouped with new guitarists Jimmy Crespo and Ricky Dufay, the band released Aerosmith's greatest hits in late 1980. The record would eventually sell over 6 million copies. The new lineup of Aerosmith released Rock in a Hard Place in 1982, peaking at number 32. It failed to match the performance of Night in the Ruts. Perry and Whitford returned to the band in 1984, and their group began a reunion tour dubbed Back in the Saddle. Early in the tour, Tyler collapsed on stage, offering proof that the band members hadn't conquered their notorious drug and alcohol addictions. In 1985, Aerosmith released Done with Mirrors, the original lineup's first record since 1979 and their first for Geffen Records. After the release of Done with Mirrors, Tyler and Perry completed rehabilitation programs. In 1986, the pair appeared on Run-DMC's cover of Walk This Way. Along with appearing in the video, Walk This Way became a hit, reaching number 4 and receiving saturation airplay on MTV Walk This Way. That set the stage for the band's full-scale comeback effort. The Bruce Fairbairn produced Permanent Vacation 1987. So that album.
Yeah, no, that song relaunched them. You can't plan these stuff out. Talk about a fluke.
It was very well done. Now, Tyler and Perry collaborated with professional hard rock songwriters like Holly Knight and Desmond Child, resulting in the hits Dude Looks Like a Lady, Ragdoll, and Angel. Permanent Vacation peaked at number 11 and sold over 3 million copies. Pump. Oh, I hear some knocking.
Is that an engineer at the door? Listen, oh no, I know what it's time for.
Oh, hello.
And now it's time for Ian's Knock. A little segment we like to call Affairs to Watch, where Ian himself will rant and rave on books, reviews, musicians, artists, people, or whatever just does not go his way at them. Who knows? You might be on Ian's Knock, Knock, Knock.
As I confessed in a previous episode, I love to read books about rock musicians, events, and pop culture. Previously, I reviewed a book about Jim Morrison and found it somewhat hostile. Listen, today I'm grateful to talk about a great book, Barefoot in Babylon, The Creation of the Woodstock Music Festival 1969 by Bob Spitz. Now, Woodstock is the godfather, the grandfather, the capo di capo of all rock concerts. There is no close second. Every passing year just seems to add to its mythological status. But as with all myths, when you take a close look, you'll see the individual parts and somehow reality clicks in. And if ever a generation itself needed deconstructing, it was the self-worshipping, self-absorbed 1960s baby boomers. Good Lord. For those who need a few details, Woodstock was a music festival held August 15th, 18th, 1969 on the Dairy Farm in Bethel, New York, 40 miles, that's 65 kilometers for our Canadian friends, southwest of Woodstock. Billed as an Aquarian exposition, 3 days of peace and music, it attracted an audience of more than 400,000 people. 32 acts performed outside despite a lot of rain. Okay, there are a few elements in play here. First of all, 400,000 skinny, stinking hippies. That's a lot. That's a record at the time. Next, extremely poor planning on the part of the festival organizers, headed up by one of the luckiest men on the planet. I'm talking a guy named Michael Lang. And I'm talking like a Ringo Starr level of luck. You have to use quantum mechanics to get an idea of the size of the good fortune. Most people know Lang, but he's a curly-haired moppet, featured prominently in the award-winning documentary of the concert. This guy had a very detached management style, if I can call it that. He had little experience, but was a smooth operator in a leather vest and love beads. His actions contributed to the festival losing millions of dollars. His dreadful planning for security operations endangered the lives of all who attended, and the sanitary conditions were deplorable, let alone food and medical supplies. And yet it worked. Michael Lang and his three associates pulled it off. They were each very talented men. Woodstock became the single most important event defining the counterculture of the 1960s. That's an impressive accomplishment. How can such incompetence lead to such success? Well, author Bob Spitz doesn't play favorites. From the get-go, he handles the players fairly, pointing out deficiencies and extolling talents. This has the effect of bringing the whole event down to earth where we can get a close look at it. As I said before, it's a system of demythologizing, and by doing so, it makes it more intimate and more human. Here's an excerpt. Quote, John Roberts and Joel Roseman, two of the four principal organizers, knew when it was time to stop pressing their luck. They had survived a near riot of 400,000 hippies, a gigantuan medical disaster, an underground revolt, what was thought to be a certain Holocaust, a massive food shortage, and mass electrocution. Not bad for a three-day celebration of peace and music. Unquote. So if you're interested in classic rock, you're likely interested in Woodstock. This book reveals the mechanics of how it just barely worked and the operators behind it all. It also touches down on the ephemeral, tie-dyed, patchouli-scented thing called 1960s brotherly love that held the whole mess together. And that seemed to gradually diminish from the inevitable Woodstock sequels, which I'm sure you've all heard of, from a lot of the West, and from Western life in general, you could say. Let's leave the last word to one of the organizers, Joel Roseman. Quote, lucky is the right word. We were strained to the point of breaking, but it never broke. People had to make do with less and less and help each other out more and more. They found a way to include the adversity. Nice line, eh? To include the adversity in the good time they were having. Everyone signed on to the instinct to take care of his neighbor. Everybody believed that they were in this unique moment together. Nice. Barefoot in Babylon, The Creation of Woodstock Music Festival, 1969 by Bob Spitz, published in 2014. I'm Ian Clark, and this was Ian's Knock. Knock. Knock.
Sometimes I just wonder if you're really pissed off that the 50th anniversary did not happen.
You know why it didn't? Michael Lang.
Bastard.
He son of a bitch. He tried. Well, of course, according to David Crosby, yeah, it was Lang who screwed up the thing. And he screwed himself out of millions of dollars. He's a promoter. These guys are hustlers. You know, so on our podcast about classic rock, we talked about the absolute pinnacle of rock. Concerts, Woodstock.
Yeah, epic.
You can never get away from that if you're talking about rock. It's like talking about electric guitarist and avoiding Jimi Hendrix. You look like a moron. You got to somehow include Jimi Hendrix. He's that important. I know we're talking about, what was it?
Aerosmith.
Oh, yeah, right. Yep.
So, coming up to where I discovered Aerosmith in my years of life is the album Pump. And that was released in 1989.
Famous album.
That's right. It continued the band's winning streak, reaching number 5, selling over 4 million copies, and spawning the top 10 singles, Love in an Elevator, Janie's Got a Gun, and actually the song I really enjoy, which is called What It Takes.
And those, actually, two of those songs did very good videos.
They're very good.
Oh, yeah.
And the thing is, that I had this discussion with my dad when he was saying, he goes, what are you listening to? I said, Dad, I said, it's Aerosmith. I said, it's too new for you, so you wouldn't understand it. He turns around and says, really? He says, Aerosmith was around in the 70s, he says, and so was I.
Oh, yeah.
And that was his answer.
So therefore,
he schooled me. Now, Aerosmith released Get a Grip in 1993. Like Permanent Vacation and Pump, Get a Grip was produced by Bruce Fairburn and featured significant contributions by professional songwriters. The album was as successful as the band's previous two records, featuring hit singles Living on the Edge, Crying, and Amazing. Well, when you have Alicia Silverstone and Liv Tyler in those videos, God bless.
Yeah. Well, you have to give it though to Aerosmith, because there's not a lot of 70s bands who actually understood video clips as much as they did, especially in the 90s.
I think it's because he had a young daughter that was kind of in that era.
Yeah, and she was an actress, but yeah. Everyone knows that video, man.
Yeah, it's good.
For certain reasons.
1994, Aerosmith released Big Ones, a compilation of hits from their Geffen years that fulfilled their contract with the label. It went double platinum shortly after its release. While Aerosmith was at the height of their revitalized popularity in the early 90s, the group signed a lucrative multi-million dollar contract with Columbia Records. They still owed Geffen two albums at that time. 1995, the band was able to begin working on their first record under the new contract, nearly 5 years after the contract was signed. The making of Aerosmith's albums usually had been difficult affairs, but the recording of Nine Lives was plagued with bad luck. The band went through a number of producers and songwriters before settling on Kevin Shirley in 1996, after the dismissal of the band's manager, Tim Collins. So
I didn't know, disappointing, I didn't know Aerosmith brought in songwriters all the time.
That's news to me. Yeah.
It's amazing whenever you do some research from
allmusic.com,
by the way. They have very good articles. Yeah. Greg Prado is one of the writers that I like to read from. He's pretty good. Nine Lives, actually, that album to me really sucked, but whatever. Finally appeared in the spring of 1997. I can't believe I even bought it. It was greeted with great anticipation, yet the initial reviews were mixed, and even though album debuted at number one, it quickly fell down the charts.
Well, you just got an explanation why you bought it.
Yeah. The Live A Little South of Sanity followed in 1998. 3 years later, Aerosmith strutted their stuff on the Super Bowl halftime special on CBS with the likes of Mary J. Blige, Nelly NSYNC, and Britney Spears, just prior to issuing their heart-stomping Just Push Play in March 2001. Again, it sucked. Next up for the band was a blues album, Honking on Bobo. That's a term a buddy of mine used to use for something else. Released in 2004. Along with two live album DVDs, which is You Gotta Move and Rockin'. Rockin' the Joint. That's another greatest hits collection. Devil's Got a New Disguise. And then the very best of Aerosmith arrived in 2006. From there, Aerosmith entered a period of volatility. A world tour followed in 2007, and the group attempted to record a new studio album with producer Brendan O'Brien, but the sessions were never finalized. Instead, another tour followed in 2009, this time supporting a jaunt for Aerosmith's own special edition of the Guitar Hero video game. And the group members that were part of Aerosmith's success are Brad Whitford, Joe Perry, Joey Kramer, Steven Tyler, Tom Hamilton, Jimmy Crespo, Rick Dufay, and Ray Tabano. Now that leads me to Aerosmith's top 10 songs. And it's kind of interesting because these songs are pretty good. Ian, you probably know a few of the albums that it comes off of, so I'm going to fire them off. Number 10, it's What It Takes from the Pump album in 1989. And this was Aerosmith's comeback. And that was it when it was in full swing with that album.
Pump was a prominent album.
I really like that album. Last Child from Rocks in 1976. Yeah. Not really too familiar
early
with that
on,
one.
No, yeah.
Early. They said here, during the 70s, Aerosmith rarely strayed from the booze-soaked guitar rock that influenced and defined them. That's just...
Well, they rarely went away from the booze anyways.
You made a point earlier. They always remind me of a version of the Stones. Like, they took the Stones, what they used to call the Rolling Stone mix, where you do a lot of upfront guitars. And that's why. And with a bit of Zeppelin peppered in. And that's the way I always interpreted that band up until the mid-80s, and they kind of switched gears.
Mama Kin, which actually... Yeah. Guns N' Roses covered on their Lies album.
Yeah, famous song.
That's from Aerosmith's 1973 album. I think that's the that the album that I like to translate in French. Probably, yes. 1973. Back in the Saddle, again from the Rocks album, 76. This is like already too many Rocks songs are on.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah. Just doesn't do it for me. This one was pretty good, actually. Wheels, you had said that soundtracks can make artists make them or break them. This one here, I Don't Want to Miss a Thing from the Armageddon.
Was that soundtrack. The album was a lot of cocktail music on that one? Because there was some cocktail music on They Use and they got really hit for it. Now I'm talking about cocktail because I'm hearing it again. That's the problem. I'm totally preoccupied with cocktail music.
And now, yes or no with Ferris Kennedy, the segment where the sick drug-addled mind of Mr. Kennedy forcibly asks Dr. Clark and medicated Wheeler yes or no questions about classic rock, and you get to hear the sick, drug-addled answers.
It makes my knees freeze.
The torture begins. And you know what? For fun, we're going to torture Wheeler first, because I always like to torture
him. Yeah, you're damn right.
We're going to torture Wheeler
first. Sitting there scratching himself. Nail him.
Yeah, the hot iron is coming this way.
Hold him down.
Steven.
Yes, sir?
Is there a huge difference in sound when you listen to music on vinyl versus CD or streaming?
There is, but I have to put an asterisk. It depends on the quality of your system.
Okay.
Smart ass.
He's such a smart ass. Do you prefer Pink Floyd with or without Roger Waters?
Musically with?
Yeah.
As a group that you would want to have a beer with? No.
Because I know he's a David Gilmour guy. That's why.
Yeah?
I know
Waters is a dreadful man.
Here's an interesting...
He's a great
musician.
Do you like King Crimson?
I do, but in small doses.
Interesting answer.
Do you like when bands name themselves after cities or states? Example, Kansas, Chicago, Toronto, and Boston.
I mean, I don't mind it. It depends on what it gives as a result.
Yeah, what about Chicoutimi?
Right? Yeah, exactly, yeah. I'm looking forward to Chicoutimi the band.
Bicomo.
Bicomo.
Live in concert. Chicoutimi. Do you like musicals?
Very rarely.
Good answer.
Yeah, I'd say.
Do you respect Rick Rubin as a producer?
Very much.
Okay. And the last question for you, kind sir. Do you think David Grohl is a better drummer than Ringo Starr?
Yeah,
isn't everybody?
This is a loaded question or what? Holy God, don't fall into that trap.
Dr. Clark.
How are you happy today?
All right. Does Andy Kim belong in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame?
Absolute positive. Yeah, no, he doesn't.
Okay. Do you agree with the statement that's been blasted all over Canada's radio that the Hip is Canada's Beatles?
Oh, shut up. We can't do that. Why can't we just do... No, this is so sad. You know, I mean, we can't do... Anyway, don't get me going.
No. Well, yes or no?
No. Like, stop the pain.
I said they're the traveling poets of Canada.
I don't know.
Are you Larry Cohen now?
Yeah, we did. Anyway, don't get me going on this whole Hip thing. It's just brutal.
Do you like renditions of a song in general?
Like different versions, that type of stuff.
Like, did you hear the new Chris Cornell Patience, the Guns N' Roses remake?
Remakes, I'm okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I used to be a little more purist, but I'm okay. They can bring something new to it.
Yeah, I was going to say, yeah.
Yeah.
Because, like, for example, American Woman, the original, is still the best.
Kravitz did an okay job, but
he could do it, a good he job, but it, sometimes the new stuff just is brutal.
Sometimes you'll realize they're doing it just for a hit. Off a song, Phil Collins used to do this, that no one's really familiar with anymore. You know, a groovy kind of love or something. You're like, come on, really? It's just for a hit.
Yeah.
You have no kind of fondness for this music, you can tell.
Do you respect Pat Boone as an artist?
As a heavy metal artist.
Actually, I respect him as a heavy metal artist. The fact that he did that. Pat Boone.
Love Letters in the Sand.
Yeah, that's right, Love Letters in the Sand. He had Tutti Frutti. He had a hit because Little Richard, being a black performer, couldn't get it released.
Did he slow the tempo, though, completely?
I know, and he's going, Tutti Frutti, oh, Rudy. A beep, bop, a loop, bop, a lop, bam, boom, got a girl. It was just so bad. No, I think he should be dragged out and beaten with a stick.
Yeah, because I had a college professor when I took the course History of Rock. He was a doctorate in philosophy, was his major, obviously, studying philosophy, and he loved Pat Boone. I don't know why, but he thought, you know, he created pop music because of his jingles. That's what he was saying.
Holy crap.
Yeah. All right.
That is strong.
That's a real bad guy.
Ian?
Yes?
Do you think the Beatles should have carried on when John Lennon left?
You and I have talked about this before. I think that it was wise. Okay, initially I said yes. Now that I think about it, shut it down. It was over. And Lennon, even though in the later years, was kind of goofing around a lot. McCartney was carrying the band. It's good that they shut it down. So no, they should not have carried on.
Perfect. Do you agree that Randy Bachman and Burton Cummings were the backbone of the Guess Who?
There's no question about it. They were the they're songwriters.
Perfect.
And, yeah.
And then last question.
Yeah.
Is Winnipeg the number two city in Canada after Toronto for Canadian bands to come out of Canada?
Oh, wow. Interesting. Yeah, they kind of almost have that reputation, don't they? I mean, Winnipeg's an interesting place for rock and roll. Yeah. I mean, what would be the second one? Vancouver?
Maybe. Montreal was big.
Yeah. But not so much for rock.
Not rock.
But yeah, Winnipeg. Calgary's more country. Alberta's more
Halifax.
Yeah. Maybe Vancouver, you're right. Oh, Halifax.
Halifax has some alt bands, kind of big C stuff happening, but nah.
Halifax is great for traditional music.
Yeah.
Well, that was it for the yes or no's.
No,
I still have my nails. It's most of my hair.
I think we were interrupted just as you're getting through a list of some kind of...
Yeah, so the next one I have here, we completed the I Don't Want to Miss a Thing. Next on the list is Dude Looks Like a Lady from Permanent Vacation. So again, this is where the comeback starts.
Right.
Janie's Got a Gun.
Janie's Got a Gun.
Yeah, from the Pump album. Sweet Emotion from Toys in the Attic.
Great song. Which he did actually live with Jeff Beck. Interesting version.
Number three of the top 10 going down.
Right.
Dream On. Actually, sorry, number two is Dream On. And the number one song that is on Aerosmith's top 10.
Drum roll, yeah.
Walk This Way.
Yeah, they're going to say, what else could it
yeah,
be?
Yeah, but it's the original one. It's not the remake. Yeah. It's kind of sucks.
Ding, 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 ding. Oh, great. That's informative.
So, now going down the list, Aerosmith has 15 albums that they've ranked. And, oh, Lord.
It's just some of them are ranked.
Yeah, so, number 15, kindly enough, is Nine Lives.
Ugh.
I didn't like it. They said it's overwhelmed after signing a huge new record deal. Well, no kidding. You know, can't believe Just Push Play beat it, but, you know, a top 10 a top 10 hit, which was Jaded. Decent song. And it was just another distraction
by the way,
that
they're going to try to include Jaded into an album called Stutter Rock. So you had Benny and the Jets, you had Jaded. He had all these albums where guys were stuttering.
That's pretty cool, actually.
Yeah. Isn't there one by the Guess Who as well? Isn't there one that he wrote because his brother had a stutter?
I don't know, really?
Yeah.
Like my American woman, maybe.
Get a Grip. That's probably one of Aerosmith's biggest hits on the strength of their power ballad smashes like Crying and Crazy. Number 12, Music from Another Dimension, came out in 2012. Number 11, my buddy Dave Morin likes this one, Honking on Bobo. That's just, is there something else on it? Rockin' a Hard Place at number 10.
Yes.
We got Night in the Ruts at number 9.
Number 9.
Number 9. Done with Mirrors, number 8. Draw the Line, number 7.
I don't know about this. Okay.
Number 6 is actually good.
Okay.
Permanent Vacation.
Yeah.
I agree. This is where the comeback started.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Number 5, self-titled Aerosmith.
Yeah, sure. Remember the album.
Number 4, Pump.
Cover. Yeah. Good album.
Number 3 is Get Your Wings. Number 2, Rocks. And obviously, Ian and Wheels, you know what number 1 is.
Cat Stevens, greatest hits. I'm not sure.
My album?
Yeah. Toys in the Attic.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
It's an interesting list. Like, it's... You could almost debate that for 10 minutes. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, thanks very much. Quite informative. Aerosmith.
Yeah.
And, of course, Steve Tyler went on to be a judge on America's Most Guilty or something.
And I hear some more...
Oh, man.
Some piano. You hear piano? Yeah. He's like, is Billy Joel around here?
Yeah, he's doing that New York State of Mind thing, and it's really, really irritating.
Oh, hello.
The music at night, it sounds bright on Wheeler's turntable. He shines a light, he keeps his vinyl in sight, and gives you his magnificent review. Now here's a clue we have for you. It's time for Wheeler's Vinyl Review.
So today we're going to talk about one of the seminal albums of the 70s.
Did you say seminal? Okay.
You're so perverted, sir.
I just want to get through this.
So it's Imagine by John Lennon.
Hell yeah, sure.
But in this case, it's a box set.
Not one of, like, there's six albums. Nine versions of Imagine.
Imagine I had no money.
Cut, you know.
So basically, two Blu-rays, four CDs, and two LPs.
Oh, stop the pain.
Imagine if I didn't stay with Yoko. No.
Imagine we have to say it is probably the most loved Lennon album of all time.
Sure.
Although it can be easily argued that the first solo album of classic Ono Band actually has a more enduring and significant following. Because frankly, outside of Imagine, can a lot of people name a lot of the songs on this album?
I know. Instant Karma, is that on there? The War is Over?
Merry
Christmas, John.
So this is Christmas.
Get out of here, Yoko.
So to be fair, so Imagine, I'll give the grade right away so we can get over with. So of course the music is a 10 on 10.
Yeah,
that's kind of you.
And the sound is amazing. Especially, I mean, the LPs are extraordinarily high quality. But if you have a good setup also for your digital, the Blu-ray sounds really amazing as well. And it's a remix of a lot of the songs. No clonkers there. I mean, Imagine is the legendary one, but all of the other songs are really good. Mm-hmm. And this is their second attempt, actually, at a remix. The first one was in 2000, and that one really sucked the big one.
Really?
And it still costs a lot of money today because it's on the Mobile Fidelity label, which is, if you're a collector, is legendary. They have very high quality records on that label. Unfortunately, some of the mixes can be very touch and go, and the one in 2000 was abysmal, according to a lot of fans. Sorry. And that being said, the remix here is really interesting because they've taken what has been called in the business the raw studio mixes, and are basically these ear witness, if we can call it that.
Yeah, okay, that's good.
Of this time in Lennon's career. And they're playing around with some of the stuff that he was doing for the quadrophonic four-channel mixes, which, if you've ever tried to listen to a quadrophonic vinyl album, is a real pain. But nowadays, with home theater system, it's really easy.
Yeah, good point.
So you can hear the stuff that Lennon actually wanted you to hear in surround sound. So it's actually quite interesting. But the really interesting part of this box set, if you want it, for collectors, is that there's a huge book that's included. And it's filled with amazing information. You got full credits for every engineer, muse, and the guy who sold him grass on the album. I'm exaggerating,
probably not far from it. Yeah.
And it's filled with high-quality pictures, so I highly recommend it. If you have a Beatle lover in your life, or if you're a Beatle lover yourself, and you don't have it, even if you have Imagine, this one is actually really interesting. It's a really good time that you're going to have listening to this.
Well, it's a lot to listen to, my God.
I was going to say. Really? So we're done.
Thanks very much.
Well, that was very good. I'm glad you didn't talk about Lennon's album of called The Two Virgins, where they're naked on the cover. Remember when I told you about that?
It's quite disturbing.
And was it sold in a brown paper bag?
Yeah, it was.
And it's like, he's just an effing idiot.
And that's being kind. He went through a bad time.
Yeah.
You know, imagine McCartney doing that. He'd like a puppy dog on this thing. Anyway, thanks very much.
Well, and that's it.
That's
a wrap.
It's a wrap.
So that's a wrap. So to my left,
Dr. Ian Clark, bidding you adieu.
To the
Stephen
right,
Stephen Wheeler,
without the anal beads. And yours truly, Ferris Kennedy. Have yourself a great day.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.